Glenn Parker, High Vibration Foundation. I wanted to do a movie review and book, they're both the same, on The Diving Bell and The Butterfly. First, the book came out about 97, and about 10 years later, 2007, the movie came out. Came out in French, and it's JonBenet Bobby. That's the best I can pronounce it. I've heard it pronounced different in French. I've heard it pronounced different in English and every different, you know, version thereof. Friends from the UK pronounce it a little differently because they have an accent, and I picked up some weird stuff along the way. So forgive me if that isn't exactly how you pronounce his name, but that is as close as I could get. And I'm going to give you a spoiler alert. Don't watch this if you haven't seen the movie, or if you don't care about spoilers. On with the show. In 2007, it was done in French. It was French. It was, you know, this all happened in France outside of Paris, I believe it was, the rehabilitation center. Well, not too far out of, you know, not close, but not too far either. So it was a very inspirational movie. I recommend it to all of my coaching clients, both business and personal, in that if you have anything in your personal life that's bothering you, and you're whining about it, or you're just pushing this threshold where you could just never get around it, and you want some cited examples of real life people that have traversed great difficulty in produce something that is still teaching people today, this is your primary example right here. So for instance, this person had a very, very rare stroke where your neurology is intact. However, the connections to your physical prowess, where you can actually move and speak or swallow or do anything, is totally destroyed. So he only had use of one eye. The other one had to be sewn shut, and he could only blink that eye. It was basically the only motor control that he kept. However, his mind was at full capacity. He could pretty much do whatever he wanted to do. And he had, was it Vogue magazine or Elle magazine? He was the managing editor or the editor at the time. And so obviously, you know, mover and shaker, very highly organized to be able to do something like that, very highly creative and able to manage highly creative people to be able to go through that process and see that photo shoots are done and manage the editorial processes and all of that. So highly creative mind, intact, sitting in a shell that no longer moves or does anything that he would like to do. He's in his 30s somewhere, mid-30s or just late 30s, a rare type of stroke to actually have a stroke at all at that point in time. So he could only use one eye, and through physical therapists establishing an alphabet by how many times he blinks, or she would go through the alphabet, and when she hit the letter he wanted, he'd blink, and okay, that's A, and that's G, and that's Z. And he actually, in the course of about a year, ever take, just before he passed away, he finished the book, and it was published, and he called it the Diving Bell and the Butterfly, and it was about his personal journey of being on top and going into a place where he wanted to die and he didn't want anything to do with being really rehabilitated, which is usually the first reaction. You know, your life is no longer yours anymore. And he blinked this book into existence, an entire book. I challenge anybody to write a congruent book, let alone blink one into existence. And they submitted to a publisher that already kind of wanted to have a book from him, and they loved it, and they published it in 97. And it's his personal story of being real rehabilitated. They couldn't rehabilitate him. Eventually, he did pass away. It was right around, he lived for about a year, a little over a year, from my understanding. And they shot the movie in the same hospital he was actually staying at, and some of the staff members that took care of him were in the movie, which I think is great from a cinematic standpoint, where you're actually having real life elements, especially the physicality of where he was staying and, you know, the things that they're showing in the background and the places where they were doing the rehabilitation and the swimming and doing these types of things were physically where he was really at. So you really are in his head and can see a lot of the things that he was personally seeing, which I think are really good for congruity for these types of things and to give people more of a real life type of feel for what the man was going through at the time. And the person that was the main character that played JonBenet Bubby, his wife was one of the physical therapists, not actually originally, but played one of the physical therapists, and then one of the other physical therapists were one of the ones that were actually at the hospital. And they show the hospital and a lot of the hospital and things that go on, and they have some very, you know, dream type of lucid things that are going on, and they flash back and forth and do so. This would really do the point of view of him actually looking out of the one eye on everybody is brilliant, actually, to see things from his point of view and hear his voice. They had him locked up in a room, the actor, and there was no sound, there was no ambient sound whatsoever as they shot these things, excuse me. And then he would, you know, they had he could see what they were doing. They fed in the camera feed, and so they would have people in the beds, and you know, the camera would be like this, and you know, he would be doing his commentary, his monologue, his inner monologue was coming out of what he was thinking, and they got this and they captured it in the book, and he wrote all this out. So from that standpoint, if you have any challenges in your life, if anything's going on, and you know, say you want to write a book, or you want to do this, or you want to do that, and you're just not getting around to it. This man lost all motor control and blinked the book into existence with one eye. And I only have one eye. I can't see out of this eye. I lost it when I was 18 months old to a rare cancer. And so I can kind of empathize with somebody with one eye, but somebody who can't move and that can only blink and to write a book. Let's just say anything that's going on in your life, not to trivialize it at all, I'm just saying, in contrast, if a man can accomplish writing a book from what is going to be his deathbed, he knows he's not gonna, nobody lasts long under those circumstances, and he knew that. They can't rehabilitate you because your body isn't neurologically responding. The connections are broken down. They can only do so much for you for so long before the body just renally, everything just, you know, goes, and there's really nothing they can do. He kept himself alive long enough through self-will and through what they could do for him to make the book. And then once it was done, toward the end there, his body was failing. So I think it's an inspiration for anyone to live up to. You know, if you want to accomplish something in your life, challenge yourself to be as brave as JonBenet Bubby was. I mean, he was so brave and determined to get that done, and his kids would come out and visit him, and he'd spend some time with them over the weekends or whenever they could come out. And, you know, they'd sit at the beach, and you couldn't talk to him. He's drilling on himself and all this stuff. But they got to spend time with him, and they knew Daddy was there. So to do all that and to document it for other people that might be going through things that seem challenging and that are challenging, to give you contrast to see, hey, you know, here's what I did. I challenge you, and I don't know that he did that in the book that I could recall. I challenge you to, you know, basically by doing this, he's saying that, here, this can be done. I challenge you to do the same in whatever situations you're feeling that are challenging for you in your own life. So I challenge you to do the same. You know, I've had some challenges in my life, and you look through my videos and you can see some things, you go, whoa, that's crazy. I watched this during a time where it was very challenging for me, and I'm like, hey, you know, I was already pretty much getting things done, but I'm like, you know, if he can do a book, blink a book into existence, I think I can go ahead and muddle through what's going on and figure out some solutions to that. So I think that's everything I wanted to share. If you haven't, or if you have seen it, I would suggest rewatching it, because it is, I try to watch that once a year at least, to have a refresher. because it is very inspirational, and I think cinematically it's fantastic just the way it's done and from what I've explained. Now you can see they discuss all this in the behind the scenes and in the commentary. You know, they show that they did it at the hospital, and they show the process of getting the release on the book, and you know, talking to family and saying, hey, we want to do this, and we want to do this in this way to honor him and to show what he was going through as much as possible, and all the time they spent at this hospital rehabilitation center, and how accommodating they were, because you know they knew what he was going through and that he wrote the book, and that the people there wanted to actually be a part of this process and were honored to be a part of this process. So I think it was just fascinating process altogether. I love film, and I went to UCLA for film and television, and was involved a lot in those types of processes. And the cinematic process is fascinating for me personally. And then to have manifestation at a time where you pretty much know that that's going to be the last thing you do, and to be brave enough to grind that out, that's, I think, just that to the human spirit alone, male, female, that's just fantastic. So thank you very much. Love and light, and I hope that was helpful for you.